In this video, we're going to look at some mistakes you can make when trying to use the tinySA. In the first application, we are using the supplied telescopic antenna to try to capture a 20 MHz signal that is present somewhere in the vicinity of the tinySA. But as you can see, there's not much signal to see. There's a big bump at the supposed to be a flat noise floor, so there's a lot of disturbances and no signal to see. And the tinySA is specified to have a noise floor at minus 90 dBm with 0 dB attenuator and its widest resolution bandwidth. But as you can see, there's much more noise here. So the question is, why is there so much noise? There's nothing weird in the setup. The telescopic antenna is connected to the low input, and the USB-C is connected to supply the voltage. Now we can see what happens if we remove the USB-C. And now all the noise disappears and the 20 MHz signal is visible. And why is that happening? If you plug in the USB-C cable, then the USB-C cable becomes part of the antenna. And inside the USB cable, there are those very high frequency signals, and they are injected into the measurement path. So you not only see the signal that is arriving at the antenna, but also everything that is present on the USB-C. For instance, what I can do is I can make a connection to the tinySA from the PC and see if there's any change in the patterns that we see. So the connection is made, and now you see all kind of traffic coming. I'm going to add some additional USB communication. It's now doing auto refresh in the screen capture mode. So a lot of disturbances. So you can say, well, okay, but what if I now disconnect and unplug the USB cable at the computer side? Still not entirely flat, but I've unplugged the USB-C cable at the computer. Still not entirely flat. Now I will slowly remove the USB plug away from the computer or from the hub that I'm using. And what you see is that the USB cable picks up noise from other USB cables that are in its vicinity. And when I remove the USB cable away from all the other noise sources, the noise is minimum. It is even less if I unplug the USB cable. So this very nicely demonstrates that when you are trying to capturing signals in the free air, you have to be very careful about where possible signals will be coming from, and it could be very well coming from your USB cable, and because it's almost impossible to shield everything there, and the tinySA is fairly sensitive, you will get a lot of noise if you do the measurements with the USB connected. In the second example of what can go wrong, I've connected a signal source giving a minus 75 dBm 20 MHz signal to the low input of the tinySA using a coax cable. But as you can see on the screen, this is even far worse than when using the antenna. So how is that possible? The coax cable is connected, but there's so much noise and so much disturbances on the screen, it's impossible to do the actual measurement. And the problem that we see here is because the ground of the coax cable is not the only connection between the tinySA and the signal generator. Both are connected using USB to a computer, so there's two ground connections between the two devices, one through the coax and one with the USB cables. And if the ground connection of the coax cable is not good, you see all the ground currents that are there in the USB cables. So look what's happening if I tighten the SMA cable better. Still not perfect. Tighten the other side also very good. And now the ground of the coax cable is a lower impedance connection, so the currents now go through the SMA cable instead of the USB cables, and the 20 MHz signal becomes visible. So when you're doing measurements using coax cable, make sure that you understand what ground path you have between the various devices, and make sure that the best ground connection is always through the coax cable and not in any other ways. Because if I just slightly unscrew the coax cable here, you get all kinds of disturbances. And that, of course, depends on the quality of the SMA cable and the SMA connectors. But it can be very, very bad, as you can see here. In this last example of what can go wrong, we are looking at the measurement of a harmonic of a 20 MHz signal. So we're looking in particular to the third harmonic at 60 MHz. And as you can see, we've used the tinySA in all its default settings and centered it on 60 MHz with a span of 10 MHz, and we see that the strength of the third harmonic is about minus 48 dBm. So now the question is, can we believe this measurement? And the answer is no, because we're probably making a mistake here, because we are measuring an harmonic. And when you measure a harmonic, it means there is for sure another signal within the bandwidth of the tinySA that is much stronger than the signal that we are interested in, and that is also reaching the mixer. And that signal may create harmonics inside the tinySA. If you look here to the minus 48 dBm, I will show you what happens when you set the frequency over the full range so that it includes the fundamental. And as you can see, the measured harmonic is now at minus 57 dBm. But you can also see that because the fundamental is now present, the tinySA sees that there's a strong signal and it starts to apply attenuation, minus 19 dB attenuation in this case. And with that attenuation, the internally generated distortion disappears. Because if you keep your signals below minus 25 dBm, the signals that arrive at the mixer, then you will have very little internal harmonic generation. So we can simulate that by looking again at the, it was 60, so 55 MHz. Look again at this signal. And you saw it was for a moment on minus 57 dBm, and then it switches to minus 48 dBm. If we now change the attenuation to 19 dB, you see you get the 56 dBm signal. So if you're measuring a harmonic or otherwise a weak signal, and it is possible that there are other stronger signals present at the input of the tinySA, and those signals could possibly get into the mixer, you always have to change the value of the attenuator to see if this change has any impact. Go from 0 to 10 dB. Now you see that we're 57 dBm. So 10 dB is necessary, because if you increase the attenuation and the signal then reduces, that means that there's some problem in the tinySA. We're now at 57, so now we're going to change the attenuation to 15 dB. And you see there's no change. So now we are sure that even the strongest signal that reaches the mixer is not strong enough to create problems in the measurement of this harmonic. And you can go even further. You can say, well, let's go for 20 dB attenuation. And then the level is still the same, so you're sure that the measurement is okay. I hope these three simple examples of what can go wrong can help you to prevent mistakes when doing measurements with your tinySA.